Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. This is the second video on recognizing the symptoms of fraud. In the previous video, we discussed the role of symptoms in fraud detection and accounting indicators of fraud. In this video, we will delve into the importance of internal controls in aiding fraud detection and identify various symptoms of fraud. Please like, subscribe and share my channel to search for accounting lessons and hit the notification bell button to alert you for the latest video. For all of your questions, comments and suggestions, please put them in the comment section below. And for webinar and guest speaker invites, please send me a message at accountingamir@gmail.com. Accounting is a K. We hope that this video helps students in their academic development and teachers in enhancing their lesson plans and teaching methodologies. If you have watched the previous videos, but then by this time you may be knowing that fraud occurs when there is pressure, opportunity and rationalization. Lack of internal controls or their override heightens fraud risk. Internal control involves the control environment, accounting system, and control procedures. The common fraud symptoms include lack of duty segregation, inadequate physical safeguard, absence of independent checks, insufficient authorization, poor documentation, control override, weak accounting systems. Studies highlight control override as a major factor in fraud cases. Let us now talk about two instances of control weaknesses facilitating fraud. In the first case, a weakness in control enabled a customer to defraud a bank of more than $500,000. In the second, a significant internal control flaw allowed fraud to persist for several years. But before that, let us talk about cashier's check. A cashier check is drawn from a bank's or credit union's funds and signed by a cashier or teller, ensuring the bank guarantees payment. It is useful for significant payments like land purchase or home down payments. It can be obtained from bank branches, credit unions, or online platforms. Alternatively, it can be obtained through money orders, certified checks, wire transfers, or social payment apps. These checks provide security for all parties as they are drawn from the bank's account and often have security features to prevent counterfeiting. Additionally, the payee doesn't need to share personal checking account information, details, and the funds are usually available quickly by the next business day after the deposit. Let us look into the first case, the fraud detection case, Lorraine scheme at Second National Bank. This is the name of the bank. Now, Lorraine, a customer of Second National Bank, requested a cashier check for $525,000 despite having only $13,000 in her account. The branch manager, trusting Lorraine's promise to cover the shortage, issued the check. However, Lorraine was actually an embezzler who has stolen over $5 million from her employee. To repay the stolen funds, she used the cashier check from Second National Bank. The bank has a control requiring two signatures on cashier's checks exceeding 500,000. But the manager bypassed this by instructing his assistant to sign without questioning. The consequences was that both the manager and the assistant were fired for compromising the control, highlighting the importance of independent decision making. This case highlights the importance of adhering to internal controls and exercising independent judgment in financial transactions. Despite Second National Bank's control requiring two signatures on cashier's checks exceeding 500,000, the bank manager bypassed this control by ordering his assistant to sign the check without questioning. This lack of independent decision-making compromised the control, leading to fraud. The incident underscores the significance of maintaining checks and balances with financial institutions and the consequences of disregarding established protocols. Let us look into the second case. In the Hochfelder case, an internal control weakness led to fraud that eventually reached the US Supreme Court. The court ultimately ruled that Ernst & Ernst, a prominent accounting firm, was not negligent in conducting an audit related to the fraud. But before we discuss the case, let us talk about escrow. Escrow is a financial process used when two parties are uncertain about fulfilling their obligations in a transaction. Escrow is a legal concept describing a financial agreement whereby an asset or money is held by a third party on behalf of two other parties that are in the process of completing a transaction. It is utilized in various industries like internet transactions, banking, real estate, and more. Consider a company selling goods internationally. To ensure payment upon goods arrival, the buyer places funds in escrow with an agent. Funds are released to the seller upon goods' satisfactory arrival, ensuring transaction security for both the parties. Escrow provides security assurance for large transactions but involves fees. Escrow accounts for mortgages are in managing property taxes and insurance payments, though they may increase monthly payments. Home buyers use escrow for earnest money and closing cost. For instance, John puts $5,000 in escrow as earnest money to show his interest in buying a house. At closing, he sets up an escrow account with the lender of property taxes and insurance along with his mortgage payments. Let us look into the case related to that. This is the case of fraudulent practices at First Securities Company of Chicago. Now, Lester Ney, president of First Securities, deceived customers into investing in non-existing escrow accounts promising high returns. However, Ney diverted the funds for personal gain, resulting in substantial financial losses to the investors. The fraudulent transaction deviated from standard practices. All customers' correspondence was handled solely by Mr. Ney, where he made payable to him. And the escrow accounts were not recorded in First Securities books or SEC filings. The fraud came to light after the Ney's death. Customers sued Ernest and Ernst under Section 10b-5 of the 1933 SEC Act, alleging a failure to conduct a proper audit. The court held that Ernst and Ernst has a legal obligation to scrutinize the adequacy of First Security's internal control system. However, the U.S. Supreme Court reversed the lower court's decision, stating that Section 10B require intent to deceive, manipulate, or fraud. The court emphasized that negligence does not fall under the statute and that recklessness may constitute intentional conduct for imposing the liability. The case underscores the significance of due diligence and accountability in financial accounting. Negligence may not suffice under certain legal statutes. Intent is crucial in determining liability. Recklessness may be treated as intentional conduct in the context of imposing legal liability. Next, let us talk about analytical fraud symptoms. Now, analytical fraud symptoms refer to unusual or unrealistic procedures, transactions, or relationships in business operations that deviate from the norms and raise suspicion of fraudulent activity. They act as warning signs for potential fraudulent activities, indicating deviations from normal patterns and promoting the need for further investigation. There is a long list of such activities in an organization. The Mayberry fraud serves as an illustration of how analytical relationships can be used to detect fraudulent activities. So let us talk about it for a while. Now, Mayberry Corporation, a conglomerate with $1 billion in sales, faced a significant fraud detected during an audit of its sheet metal division. Despite past audits showing no issues, suspicions arose when the year's examination revealed drastically inflated inventory without serious shortages. The auditors initially verified the inventory amount during the year-end count and securely deposited their findings in a box in a conference room. However, a manager at Mayberry manipulated the situation by adding fake inventory records to the box overnight, some of which displayed unreasonably high amount of sheet metal. Additionally, the manager substituted new inventory reconciliation lists to align with total of both valid and fictitious records. The auditor's discovery of the Mayberry fraud occurred during analytical test. First, they converted the 30 million inventory sheet metal inventory into cubic feet. Secondly, they assessed the warehouse volume, finding it could only accommodate half the reported amount. Thirdly, they noted discrepancies in inventory tags, with some items unrealistically heavy for the company's forklift to handle. Lastly, they cross-verified reported inventory purchases, finding purchase orders supporting only 30 million pounds, while the reported amount was 60 million pounds. Confronted with irrefutable evidence, the company's manager admitted to the fraud, which aimed to portray increased profits to meet divisional budget expectations. This case underscores the importance of analyzing the relationship between recorded amounts and their physical characteristics, a crucial aspect often overlooked by managers and auditors. So, fraud detection is crucial for maintaining integrity and trust in financial reporting. Continuous vigilance and thorough analysis is essential in preventing and uncovering fraudulent activities. Fraud detection sometimes involves identifying transactions or events that don't seem to make sense. Let us illustrate a case where an alert accountant uncovered fraud by recognizing irregularities in payments made by Don, the business manager of Regal Industries. Now, Don, the business manager of Regal Industries, was caught committing fraud by an alert accountant. The accountant noticed unusual payments to an Oldsmobile dealership, despite the company only having Cadillac as company cars. This raised suspicion as to why the Cadillacs were being serviced at Oldsmobile dealership instead of a Cadillac one, especially since the Oldsmobile dealership wasn't closer. Further investigations by the accountant revealed more red flags. Payments were made for body damage on company cars without corresponding insurance claims, and payments of the exact same amount were made to the Oldsmobile dealer every month. Now, these anomalies led to the accountant to suspect a fixed fee maintenance contract with the Oldsmobile dealer servicing the company's Cadillacs. However, no such contract existed. The accountant conducted a thorough investigation, revealing no legitimate explanation for the anomalies. Upon delving deeper, it was discovered that Don had a girlfriend working at the Oldsmobile dealership, and he was using company funds to buy her a car by making a monthly payment. This vigilant accountant saved the company approximately $15,000 by uncovering the fraud. Now, many accountants and auditors might have overlooked these irregularities, potentially missing the fraudulent activity. It is crucial to analyze transactions for consistency and legitimacy, even if they appear routine, to detect potential fraud. Fraud detection often requires a keen eye for anomalies and willingness to investigate unusual transactions or events. By staying vigilant and questioning inconsistencies, companies can mitigate the risk of falling victim to fraudulent activities. Identifying analytical symptoms is key to uncovering fraud. For a seasoned fraud investigator, his career began with his first encounter with fraud. This moment highlights the importance of recognizing analytical symptoms. What follows is the story of how this experience shaped his career. This is the case of uncovering fraud at a classic theater. The narrator recalls their time working at the classic theater in the summer of 1956. Despite his passion for mathematics and being labeled as the numbers man, he was employed in a movie theater due to the need of employment after graduating from South High and waiting to begin college. Despite an apparent mismatch between his passion for numbers and his job as a ticket taker, the narrator's analytical mindset proved valuable. The narrator, despite finding their job as a ticket taker intellectually unchallenging, developed a routine of noting down the numbers of each ticket he handled. This habit allowed him to maintain a record of the sequential order in which tickets were being processed. He observed that ticket numbers typically followed consecutive pattern. However, irregularities appeared in the sequential order. Typically, the ticket numbers followed a consecutive pattern, with each ticket number being one higher than the previous one. For example, he would tier tickets with number 57, 58, 59, 60, followed by 61, 62, 63, and so forth. This consistent sequence was expected and aligned with the natural progression of ticket sales. However, the narrator began to notice irregularities in this sequential order. Occasionally, instead of the expected continuation of numbers, there would be a sudden jump in the sequence. For instance, after tiering tickets with numbers like 65 and 66, he would encounter tickets with significantly lower numbers like 40, 41, 42. Now, this disruption puzzled the narrator as it deviated from anticipated pattern and raised questions about what could be causing such inconsistencies. This observation of irregularities in the numerical sequence sparked the narrator's curiosity and led him to wonder about the underlying reasons behind these disruptions. It served as the initial clue that prompted the narrator to investigate further. He initially viewed his habit of noting irregularities in the ticket sequence as a mere mental game to pass the time. However, he noticed a consistent pattern. The irregularities occurred after the daily break when the manager, Mr. Smith, relieved him. Upon closer observation, the narrator realized that the ticket sequence also became disrupted when Mr. Smith relieved the ticket seller during the narrator's break. This led the narrator to suspect that something suspicious was happening. He hypothesized that Mr. Smith was pocketing the ticket instead of tearing them into two when he relieved them during the break. Later, when he relieved the ticket seller, he would resell the previous pocketed tickets and keep the cash. The narrator's keen observation and analytical thinking led to the discovery of fraudulent activity by Mr. Smith. This story underscores the importance of remaining vigilant and questioning irregularities even in seemingly mundane situations. It demonstrates how critical thinking and attention to detail can uncover fraudulent behavior. The next case emphasizes the importance of comprehending the relationships between numbers in financial statements, drawing parallels to the ticket taker's understanding of ticket sequences. It suggests that with a deep understanding of financial numbers, individuals involved in financial reporting, auditing, and analysis can detect fraudulent activities sooner. So, this case describes the fraudulent activities and subsequent downfall of MiniScribe Corporation, a personal computer disk drive company under the leadership of CEO Quinton Thomas Wiles. Overall, this case illustrates how unchecked pressure to meet unrealistic targets, coupled with a lack of ethical oversight, can lead to widespread financial fraud and ultimately the downfall of a once prominent company like Miniscribe Corporation. Despite being voted most well-managed company in the industry in 1988, Miniscribe's financial statements of 1986 and 87 and the first three quarters of 1988 were deemed unreliable due to gross overstatements of sales and net income. The company reported sales has surged from 113.9 million in 1985 to 603 million in 1988 under Weil's management. Weil is known for his strict management style, set aggressive sales targets and profit targets for managers, leading to a culture of falsifying reports to meet these goals. Managers were pressured to manipulate internal documents, leading to fraudulent practices such as recording sales of bricks as hard drives, inflating shipment to warehouses, repeatedly shipping defective merchandise as sales, and understating bad debt expenses. Furthermore, the company engaged in unethical practices like changing shipping dates on overseas shipments to recognize revenues before sales were made and altering auditors' working papers to conceal the fraud. These schemes resulted in a significant overstatement of net income and sales. The extent of the fraud became apparent when inventory records revealed that only 4 million of the reported 12 million in inventory actually existed. To offset these overstatements, the company has to book a 40 million charge to income in 1989. However, Miniscribe's financial troubles continued, leading to its bankruptcy filing on January 1, 1990, with liabilities far exceeding its assets. Now, this case discusses the failure of analytical procedures to detect the massive fraud at WorldCom, despite the use of sophisticated auditing software by Arthur Anderson. Now, Arthur Anderson used sophisticated auditing software and analytical procedures to identify anomalies in financial statement line items. The goal was to detect significant variations that might indicate the need for further investigation. The case discusses the failure of analytical procedures to detect the massive fraud at WorldCom, despite the use of sophisticated auditing software by Arthur Anderson, the auditing firm responsible for examining WorldCom's financial statements. Arthur Anderson's analytical procedures included the use of sophisticated auditing software were intended to identify significant variations or anomalies in financial statements, line items that might indicate the need for further investigation. However, these procedures failed to uncover the fraud perpetrated by WorldCom management. One reason for the failure of analytical procedure to detect the fraud was the manipulation of financial data by WorldCom management. Specifically, WorldCom manipulated expenses by improperly capitalizing them as fixed assets, thus artificially inflating the value of property, plant, and equipment. This manipulation offset significant decreases in the purchase of fixed assets, making the changes in asset values appear consistent over time. The case suggests that Anderson's analytical procedures may not have been sufficiently sensitive to detect this manipulation, because they analyze financial data at high level of aggregation, while some ratios related to revenues, expenses, and property, plant, and equipment showed volatility, they did not reveal unusual behavior for the critical year of the fraud 2000 and 2001. Additionally, these ratios may not have been sensitive enough to detect subtle changes in financial data caused by management manipulation. Despite potential disaggregation of data and analysis at a more refined level, Anderson's analytical procedures failed to identify the manipulation of financial data by WorldCom management. The fraud went undetected because management disguised changing conditions by shifting expenses to property and equipment accounts, thereby maintaining the appearance of historical trends and meeting expectations. In summary, the failure of analytical procedures to detect the WorldCom fraud underscores the limitations of relying solely on such procedures for fraud detection. Management manipulation for financial data and limitations of analytical methods underscore the needs for auditors to exercise skepticism and employ a comprehensive approach to fraud detection. So this completes the second video on recognizing the symptoms of fraud. I hope you have enjoyed this presentation, and if you found value in this video, then please like, subscribe, and share my channel and hit the notification bell button to alert you for the latest video. For webinar and guest speaker invites, please send me a message at accountingamir@gmail.com. Remember, effective questioning brings insight, which fuels curiosity, which cultivates wisdom. If you have any question or any suggestion regarding this session, then please put them in the comment box below or by email, and inshallah, I will reply you back. Thank you so much and happy learning.